Thank you, Chairman. I've got to say, I mean, it feels like I've been here before, to say the least. I gave four deputations to this planning committee on the applications in Walsash, and lo and behold, we're in the same situation again. So once again, we're talking about highways. It's exactly the same as in the Western Wards. It's a problem, although we're told it's not a problem. We've got the same with doctors in that way, and schools. In doctors, I think it's disappointing in the report that it's nothing to do with us, it's done with the health providers. But we have, on this committee in the past, actually been in touch with the CCG and actually get some kind of report from them. Because I think we just dismiss this thing as, you know, it's nothing to do with us. It is to do with us because of what's going on. I was very pleased to hear from the deputy that the community involvement, I think that is very important, and I think it probably is missing in most areas at the present moment. And I think probably developers need to actually pick this up, because, you know, I think they don't actually realise the importance of it. I'm also a bit concerned about the ecology. We've got quite a number of different sort of differing papers on ecology, etc. And I see we have a senior ecologist with us this evening, so perhaps I'd like to hear some words from her as to actually the points that have been raised today, because I think it is important that we actually understand where we are with it. And once again, we're all going to be faced with the situation on the five-year housing supply. We all understand that. We all know that if we reject it, it will go to appeal and it could end up with damages against us. But, you know, when I look at the DSP 40, when I look at the paragraphs 3 and 5, yeah, one could reject it on those two paragraphs alone, I think, actually. So, you know, I'm still sort of reserving my right as to where I go with this, but I'm not happy. I think the other thing I need to mention is on the highways, and a number of us have mentioned it as well, of course, is that, you know, the location into the site, it does look very similar, as already been said, to the Sovereign Crescent Florence one that we rejected last month as well, actually. But certainly, that's where I am at the moment, but I certainly would like the ecologist to perhaps give us a few words on what she thinks about the situation. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Councillor. So when it comes to planning applications, the reviewers submitted reports, and in this instance, the submitted reports were written and all the surveys carried out in accordance with best practice guidance. There was nothing to basically challenge. However, we have had a lot of communication from the residents and basically telling us about their concerns, and also submitting a number of reports that were carried out either by themselves or experts. So they were all carefully reviewed again. And I think to kind of make it a bit more understandable, I'll give a couple of examples. For example, a BAT report was produced, and the BAT report, it was carried out by a person who'd done basically 15 evenings in just 1 month, and the survey data was basically, it had under-recorded the bat species, and that's not in line with best practice guidance. Best practice guidance says that the surveys need to be spread out. So from the month of April to October, they have to do one survey per month, basically one evening. So obviously the results weren't that different. It wouldn't change the mitigation. However, it's just fair to point out that, you know, it wasn't done correctly. Again, the reptile data, Councillor Cunningham kind of mentioned that juveniles, slow ones, do not kind of exist on that side. They do exist on that side. It is in the applicant's ecologist report. What we couldn't basically validate when it came to the report submitted from the public was that they'd taken into account the number of juveniles on that site, and that is not in line with best practice guidance. Best practice guidance says that it needs to be the peak number of adult reptiles found. So, and there was a lot of argument against that, but, you know, it's our responsibility to basically play by the rules and to follow legislation. There were other concerns that they were quite valid, and we looked into them, and there were concerns about badgers, so we basically asked the applicant's ecologist to to undertake an updated survey, which they did, and they found the active Bedgeset, which the residents had told us about. However, this was in the area which is not going to be developed, it's in the mitigation area. So again, it didn't change, you know, the results of the mitigation. Yes, again, issues about ancient hedge, and we just explained to the residents that, you know, it's not an ancient hedge based on ecology matters, it's based on archaeology and history. And again, we explained to them that, you know, when it comes to ecology, that hedge is going to be retained, half of it is within an ecology mitigation area, so there won't be any impact. And the other half, in the northern half, there is at least a 2 meter buffer. And again, we have to stick to the legislation, whilst I personally might like, I don't know, a 10 meter buffer, but, you know, we can't impose that on the applicant or the ecologist, so we just have to stick by the rules. I would personally say that this is one of the better development proposals in the area, just because they are developing only half of the site, and the southern half has been used for ecology mitigation, which Natural England supported. And you know, whilst the public will be able to enjoy that area, it's got restricted access, which again is going to reduce disturbance of the wildlife, so it's going to be beneficial. Thank you.
I think my only sort of problem really is that we've seen the photographs of these dead reptiles, etc. on the site. So it strikes me it's obviously not working properly at the moment. Can you comment on that at all?
The applicant's ecologist, when they contacted us and asked for permission to carry out the vegetation clearance, and we advised against it just because of the interest in the site. However, it is not illegal, and it in some cases it is common practice to clear some vegetation to reduce the impact later on in the year, because they wanted to avoid nesting bird season. And when we received concerns and phone calls and emails from the residents in respect of you know, there's no one there to supervise the work and the you know, dead reptiles. Because it wasn't a planning matter, all we could do was to contact the applicant's ecologist directly by phone numerous times and email. And you know, every time they assured us that they had ecologists on site supervising the works. And we also advised the residents that, you know, if there are they think if there's a breach of legislation, i.e., you know, any reptiles have been killed, they should contact the police. But other than that, you know, we were assured that everything was getting done by the books and in accordance with all the ecology reports and mitigation measures that they submitted.
Right, on that one, I've been waiting for about 2 years for this. Right, I'll start back to front. I'll start with the ecology, because that's what everybody's bringing up. I went to the site this morning, back to my mum, and for the life of me, why would they need to clear that when these houses are going to take possibly one or two, maybe a bit longer, years to build? They could have left the south side completely alone. And in fact, one of the suggestions that I've got is that we don't want anything done with it. I mean, they're talking about usable open space and path through. We're trying to create a replacement nature habitat. Now, forgive me, I'm not very nature orientated. I'm not too knowledgeable. But it seems to me that the south side could have stayed exactly as it was, because you translocate, or whatever you call it, the creatures. Now, I'm told that some of those creatures aren't suitable to go on the other side, and had they been suitable, they'd be on the other side. I don't know. But quite frankly, I have never seen a site. It's disgraceful what's been done on that site. I mean, I just stood there and I just looked up. I thought, I can't believe this. And there were about seven or eight men in there. There were chainsaws going, there were machines grinding everything up. All in advance of getting a planning permission. And then I thought, well, four-bedroom houses, where are they located? They've got a lot of view, aren't they? So is this more about creating a view down to the sea, or is it about creating that habitat? So the first thing I suggest is, in all this, whatever the outcome of this decision, is that that land should be left alone, totally alone. Just let the creatures live in there. Don't introduce humans into it, because there's no point. There's a badger set in there, and so on and so forth. And they've trashed it so badly that the creatures, I'm told by a lady with a degree, that there are creatures that are currently still hibernating. They're slightly underground. So one of the things that does worry me completely is they're getting such a budge on this site. How is that going to be stopped to allow these creatures to come up and be translocated? Because it seems to me that they could even be on site next week with great big bulldozers and crush a load more creatures. It just doesn't add up. And with respect, members will know, when I get a headache, that's because I'm listening to baloney. Right? And this eco outfit that have done this, they don't appear to have taken any notice of anything. Even on an insensitive basis, the developers should have held off. This has become such a sensitive site, with so many people concerned about it, then, in my mind, it should have been left alone until they got a planning consent. No wonder so many people are giving me emails and saying it's a done deal and all the rest of it. Yes, we need the houses. Yes, it's a suitable site. I'm not even going to argue that. But right back at the beginning, and I'll come on to the bit that I was going to bring forward first, when Radium held their open thing at the old hall up the top of Castle Street, one of the things I said to them was, there has to be a price to get into that land. Price, as I see it, is you buy a property on Seafield and you put a proper two-way access in to get in and out. No, they said we can't afford to do that. No, there won't be enough money generated to do all that. So then there was a suggestion that, well, at least we have the footpath connection to where the existing access into the old allotments goes. They totally ignored that. In fact, they've done nothing. And out of respect, Persimmon Homes, you remember they came in for their full consent? They have followed every stretch of how they should deal with the nature side of things. They came to us, they said, we'll provide extras, we'll do more than what we've even agreed. This outfit have totally ignored everything. And it's not a wonder. Why have we got all these residents here? Are they pleased about it? No, of course they're not. They're devastated, the same as... Well, I came away from there this morning, I thought, I can't believe this. Morant Drive, in 95, the application then was turned down on Countryside, which we can't substantiate anymore. But equally, number two was the lack of a proper access, Morant Drive being unsuitable. And at that time, half the houses were going out of the other end of the site, Tattershall. Right? So now, it's down to this. Now, I did meet Dave McMahon down there this morning, and I had to agree with the road width can take two vehicles passing. But that's if all the residents don't park on the street. And then you come up to what I don't like, which is a pinch point, which just barely allow one vehicle to come through at a time. People now, what's changed since 95? There are more cars on the road. People now, they get into a house, they rent it or whatever. What's the first thing they buy? A bed? A settee? No, they don't get a car. So even if the cars here aren't, if you move them about, say, well, the social housing side, perhaps they won't have a car. I doubt it, most of them do. But then you've got four bedroom units, there could be four cars, three cars. So I'm thinking that it's possibly 100 cars coming in and out of Morant Drive. And there's the clue, drive. It's not a road, it's not an avenue, it's a drive. My drive's bigger than that. To my own house. Right? So I cannot support this application in its present form. I agree we need the housing. I agree that at some stage it's going to have to come forward. But what they should have done was gone after a property in Seafield, preferably the ones adjacent. They could have offered a deal, have a house in there, brand new, we take yours down. They've done it along Southampton Road. They've put 8 houses at the back alongside the railway. They took a house down, moved it over, built, rebuilt the house and created a driveway in and out. That's what was necessary here. It fell on deaf ears. They promised me they'd look at it. They'd come back to me. Radiant Homes. Never did. So, I don't like it at all. Councillor Andrews.
Yes, I'm not really fond of it either. We've been quoting DSV 440 today. I think this, if you look broadly at the provisions of the requirements of DSV 40, this site meets all of the conditions that that demands. I think you've got to look behind some of those conditions as well. Condition 2, for instance, says there should be integration with the existing area. There's no transition between the bungalows in Northern Drive and this particular development. It is stark change from one typical type of dwelling in this area to a modern type, a different type of dwelling. So there's no transition there. A lot of talk about ecology today, but there seems to be nothing in here. And one of the deputies mentioned there should be a future environmental group to decide what's going in the southern half and to be part of it and to manage it. I think that's very important. Instead of that, you've got total destruction of whatever's there of environmental value. And all that's left is a big piece now of open scrubland. Even when it grows up, it's not going to be much more than that. So the future, I think, demands that there should be local residents' involvement in what goes in the southern arc, if and when it's developed, and for the future management of it, so as the residents can take ownership of it. Access, I too went there. It must have been quite busy up there today, I think, with traffic. So I was trying to put on this road as well. I was dismayed to find this pinch point. It seems to be an afterthought in highway terms, because it's different material, it's cobbles setting concrete or whatever. I drove through there and found it extremely difficult to get out. And the chairman's quite right, that access road looks like a drive to service the vehicles that are there. To put this high number of additional vehicles through that same road, to me, it seems unacceptable. So I think we should draw parallels with what we did last time, the last meeting with Sovereign Crescent. That's, each application's got to be dealt with on its own merits. I don't think we can say we can refuse that one, so we should refuse this one. But I think the same conditions apply. That road is inadequate for its intended future use. I think I'll be supporting the chairman in refusing